A Little Hatred by Joe Abercrombie, a book I have been very much so wanting to get to. It was even sent to me early by Orbit, but I only just recently was able to finish it, and I feel bad for that. I should have gotten this out sooner for y'all. I've just had the craziest of weekends. But now we have a review of a book I am madly in love with. And before the comments are even written, I had so many people send me messages or comment on my Goodreads that I cannot read this before I read the other standalone First Law books. It's impossible. I'll never understand it.
The brilliances of the story will go over me.
And guys, I got the book. Yeah, I learned a few things, and I'm sure some stuff was spoiled for me for the First Law standalone books, but that's fine. I'm not really a person who's bothered by spoilers that much, and it's completely okay. And I still really loved this, and through context clues, understood it. I'm fine. I also want to say I love the fact that Robin Hobb is the one giving the front cover quote. I love Robin Hobb, but it's just not who I would have expected to give a front cover quote for a Joe Abercrombie First Law book. But that's great. That's beautiful. And two final things before we get into the deep, meaty review. The biggest complaint I have, honestly, for this, where's my map? There's no map in the book. I'm a fantasy nerd, man. You gotta give me a map. It's a stupid nerdy thing that will actually bother me, but there's no map in this book. And I'm only kind of joking that, Joe, get me a map. And the final thing I want to say is whoever played Butcher in the recent The Boys series on Amazon absolutely needs to be involved with the First Law adaptation whenever it does happen, because he embodies a lot of what I like in this, and I think he'd be a great fit. I don't know who he'll play. You all decide that. I just want him in here. But now getting into the meat of this book review. What did I think of A Little Hatred? Well, I kind of meant it when I said my biggest complaint was there's no map. This is another outstanding execution from Joe Abercrombie. The Lord Grimdark, as he jokingly called himself once, proved himself to arguably actually earn that title once again. It is grimdark fantasy. I do have to go over these things, so, you know, real quickly, let's just get this out of the way. It's grimdark fantasy, so if you're not a fan of grimdark, don't start First Law. Also, don't start with this book. You do definitely still need to just read at least the First Law trilogy before going to this one. Although, according to everyone who felt the need to message me, you also need to read all the standalones. Mild disagree, but okay. And for the setting of this one, we are on the cusp of an industrial revolution. And as with many fantasy settings when the industrial revolution is happening, the magic seems to be fighting it, dying out, you know, that kind of situation. All the way back from Tolkien, we've seen similar themes. But it gets the Joe Abercrombie treatment, which means we get some vile, vicious characters walking through this setting, and there's a new spin that I can't get into without spoilers. This will be a completely spoiler-free review because it is a brand new book, and I do not want to spoil it for anyone who has not finished it yet. But yes, there is the typical Joe Abercrombie characters, some repeating characters, of course, from the First Law universe as well, but this is a new guard seemingly taking up the mantle for the First Law face. The next generation literally is coming in here, and they are almost just as engaging characters right off the bat that we have gotten from Joe before. It'll be really hard for him to top what he brought in the original First Law trilogy, but I can say I am definitely hooked by these ones, and I'll probably need at least one more book before I say I'm completely there and I'm with them as much as I was through The Blade itself to the end of that trilogy. I just love that Joe Abercrombie refuses to conform to what I would say is more traditional fantasy ideas, and he just seems to stubbornly sit in his ideology that people suck. They tend to work towards selfish goals, which can occasionally be good, and there are the more innocent, nicer people in these worlds, but they are systematically broken and beaten down to the point where they may not become evil, but they're definitely not as innocent and wholesome as they once were. The shining characters for me in this one were Savine, Orso, and Ricky, and I didn't listen to the audiobook, so I don't know for sure if those are the pronunciations. My dyslexic ass is trying hard here, but I think so. And through those characters, we get three very different perspectives on this industrializing world. Two people who seem to be more close to the top of the power dynamic and benefiting or struggling to benefit in great ways, and another who is just being tread on and trying trying to stay afloat as the world is flying forward in a new direction. Their home itself is the middle of an invasion battle scenario. So yeah, you get fucked up in that. So I'm going to take advantage of the rest of this review after kind of just getting through the, yes, it's as good as the rest of the first law and Joe Abercrombie is wonderful. Pick it up if you have not already and this sounds remotely appealing to you because it's pretty much the best example of anything along these lines you can get. And I want to jump into doing Grimdark properly, which again, A Little Hatred is a fantastic example of. To me, Grimdark at its core is the idea that humans pretty much suck, and it's a realistic take at the worst side of humanity taking the forefront. You're not following protagonists who you can entirely get behind and are morally righteous and you find to be just these great stellar beacons of what humanity can and should be, which fantasy very often in its past has focused on. And Joe seems to have mastered this idea that you can have a compelling, interesting protagonist who you don't agree with, who is a bad fundamentally person, or at least an incredibly selfish, self-centered one. And I think he does this by also introducing those who are a more realistic, well-rounded view at an earlier stage in life. He'll take a younger character, one who has not been so inundated in the depths of horridness in the world, and have them experience the events of a more grimy world, I guess is the best way to put it. And through the juxtaposition of their perspective on events versus those who are a little older or just younger but also been inundated with this type of lifestyle from birth, you get this breaking down of what once was innocent. And we've seen this in First Law, we're seeing it now in A Little Hatred. Those who are optimistic tend to suffer in Joe's writing. Those who do not put themselves first tend to suffer in Joe's writing. Those who trust and are not guarded tend to suffer. And if I want to read a grim, dark book, this is the kind of craft I want to see put into it. I want to see something that is unrelenting and merciless, but also well thought out, themed, and with an ideology behind it, a practice, a method to the madness, something the reader can consciously or subconsciously buy into and invest in. And this is where A Little Hatred shines oh so bright. I think it is the most blatant example of this from Joe so far. While these same ideas were definitely prevalent in the main First Law trilogy, at least I certainly picked up on them. I could be wrong, maybe I'm wrong, but I think they're there. A Little Hatred has it a little more on the surface, which maybe seems like, oh, that would be a dumbing down, but I really think paid off in spades. I believe that's because it's taking place during the turning of an age, literally and metaphorically, as this technological boom is happening. You're having these trade talks happen, and they're not boring and just mind-numbing like things from, I don't know, the Star Wars prequels, but they're fascinating because you know everyone in this room is capable of horrible things and probably has alternative motives. That combines to have an inherently more compelling conversation. And I don't know why, but I've touched on this a few times recently in the channel. It's about the idea of introducing something to the reader to just have the next scene pay off so much better, even if it's not directly referenced or mentioned. The most blatant well-known pop culture example is Chekhov's gun, but that's more for in film and direct violence as a result. But something similar is being done here for just dialogue. If you introduce that someone is a conniving person by sitting in their head for a chapter, and then four chapters down the road, you're sitting in someone else's perspective who's having a conversation with that lying, manipulative, brilliant bastard of a character who you kind of like, you are now reading so much deeper into that conversation. And Joe is smart enough and capable enough of an author to have nuggets for you to find in there. That is why First Law fundamentally works as a series and stands out from so much other grimdark that just seems to be kind of milking the genre for whatever it's worth right now. To summarize a little bluntly and maybe even a little stupidly, time and care of your craft as an author is absolutely required for Grimdark to work. You can't just focus on the bloody bits and entertain a mature adult audience. We're not into this for torture porn. We're into this because you can have so much more tension and just a tiny line of dialogue if you're willing to show us that almost everyone involved in your story has ulterior motives and is willing to do whatever to climb to the top. That's why A Little Hatred works, that's why I'm going to continue to recommend First Law of people, because Grimdark does not necessarily have the best name for itself out there right now because of people who either don't respect this part of the subgenre or are just not willing to put in the effort, and that sucks. So yes, pick up First Law if you want to see Grimdark done well. Like and subscribe if you have not already. I apologize for this review not focusing so heavily on the book and instead just turning into a rant ramble of why this works while others don't, but I think that's the best thing you could take away from such a deep in series review here. Anyway, buy the book through the affiliate link down below if you'd like to support the channel here and are experienced enough with First Law. I'll also have affiliate links to get started with the First Law series as well. Have a good one, y'all.
Peace.